Now, you've made it very clear that you want to address what you describe as these human rights violations. Why take this action? Why these sanctions?
There are actually, for our national targeted sanctions against Belarusian officials, there were two grounds. First is a massive electoral fraud, and secondly, use of violence against peaceful protesters.
We've got a little bit of a delay on the line, so please do bear with us. What is interesting is the timing of this, because you have moved before the EU have announced their sanctions. Why have you done that? And do you have confidence in the EU to be able to take the type of action you'd be looking for them to take?
Well, what we have managed to achieve in EU is a clear political assessment about the events and political crisis in Belarus, and secondly, the launch on consensus base of the targeted sanctions implementation procedure. What we would like to see is now the smoother and quicker implementation of the targeted sanctions. Such kind of crisis is indeed an issue where the timing is crucial, and therefore we, Baltic countries belonging to the wider region with Belarus, wanted to show the determination first, and secondly, surely it is also a positive signal, I believe, to our friends in Europe, but also outside Europe, who share the same view on events in Belarus, that we should act properly and immediately, and we should also include Alexander Lukashenko to the targeted sanctions list. Lukashenko is evidently a center point of gravity in these issues. Mm.
And he is one of 30 people that you've applied these travel restrictions to. You've said in your statement that you want to deal with this, you want to demonstrate action with the utmost of seriousness. How much impact do you think a travel ban on these 30 individuals will actually have in sort of engineering the outcome you want, which is remedying human rights violations?
Well, surely we should take this Baltic countries' national entry ban lists as a certain signal. A signal to the European people, but also a signal to the towards Belarus. What is our assessment, which central key figures are responsible for electoral fraud and violence? And surely, I do not mind. I do not believe that if these people are not able to enter in coming years to the Estonia, this will be avoid them using violence in remaining power. Surely, this is a political signal of our determination, and also a signal that also in European Union level we should act immediately.
Belarus has warned it will retaliate against any sanctions. Does that change your position at all?
No, it doesn't. And we have seen also that European Union has, in DK2 perspective, used different tools on addressing the human rights violations in Belarus. And I think now it is a momentum, such an uprise and such a harsh and massive breaches of human rights, that we need to be determined, we need to act. And also we have followed with great concern the recent pressure against the international and domestic journalists in Belarus.
Russia have come out to say that they can provide support to Belarus, particularly in combating these protests, as asked for by Belarus. Are you nervous about Moscow's involvement?
Not nervous, but realistic. And we have seen also that in a so-called near abroad countries of Russia, Russia has used in, well, decade history as military power, as whatever influence doctrines to control the events. And surely I do not make any illusion that also the political crisis in Belarus is a case where Russia wants to orchestrate the game. But from the security perspective, from the regional security perspective, it is surely important that Russia avoids by power influence to the domestic crisis of Belarus. And therefore, it is very important that also the Western allies would address it clearly and promptly in public, but also in bilateral talks with Russian leaders.